If you have followed my work for some time or with just a quick glance through my portfolio, it shouldn't come as a big surprise. I'm a big fan of Game of Thrones, Lord of the Rings and other fantasy-based stories. I love finding and adding that mysterious yet out-of-this-world fantasy element to my pictures. In my preparations for this trip, I was especially looking for landscape features and locations which had that element. Great Britain didn't disappoint.
This is just absolutely glorious. That was crazy, but so worth it.
Having this goal in mind, my travels led me to Brentor Church, or Church of St. Michael de Roop, which is located on the western edge of Dartmoor National Park. There's a big free parking lot, so parking shouldn't be a problem. It's fairly easy getting to the church from the parking lot by following the path across the road and up the hill.
We have now come to Brenton Church, and I have to say this is one of the most amazing church locations I have ever seen. You see up here, we have this lonely church on the top of this hill or mountain or cliff, and it looks absolutely Game of Thrones style-ish.
This kind of hill summit is actually called a tor, and that's where the name of the church, Brent Tor, comes from. According to local myths, the church was to be built at the bottom of the tor, but the devil, who didn't want to see its construction, would move the construction to the top of the hill each night to stop its construction. Dissuaded by the devil, the locals continued with its construction in defiance.
So a little bit about the composition. I found these rocks down here, which leads up to the church. See here on the back of on the display that we have here. We have these leading lines from the rocks in the foreground, and over here we have some bushes down here which makes another leading line. It is absolutely moody and it is absolutely beautiful.
On the other side of the church, there are some great compositional opportunities too, with more rocks and a couple of trees.
As I do at all locations, I always move a bit around to try to find the optimal composition. It is very hard to see on the small display when you're in the field if you have the right composition. It's way easier to judge when you sit in front of the computer and see all the pictures. So be sure to shoot a lot of different compositions. Even though they look very much the same, they do differ quite a lot when you look at them at your computer.
From the vantage point we used, you will be looking south, which means the light from the setting sun will hit the front of the church. During the summer half of the year, the light from the setting sun should also light up the northern side of the church. I'd recommend bringing a 16 to 35 mm, but there's also great opportunities with a telezoom if you want to zoom into some of the details in the surrounding landscape. When we were about to finish, a big cloud of fog rolled in and I got a few last atmospheric photographs with great use of negative space.
Thank you.
Another fascinating location I've never heard about before is Black Church Rock, which you can find along the Heartland Devon Heritage Coast. From the National Trust car park, where you can park, there's a 2 kilometer hike down to Black Church Rock. Just follow the trail behind the farm, which will lead you through a forest area. Keep to the left trails all the way to the coast. Don't cross the bridge when you're at the coast, just stick to the trail and pass the houses. Black Church Rock is a double arched layered rock formation which is extremely photogenic, with lines of layered rock running out in front of it. These lines make for an obvious and very strong foreground element. The big hole has a span of about 3 meters and a height of about 10 meters. This location is an obvious location to photograph an hour or two after high tide, since the lines of rocks leading to the rock will be partly visible, creating some very strong leading lines and removes distracting smaller stones, etc. from the composition. High tide actually occurred during sunrise, but due to very bad weather and a couple of beers too many the evening before, we decided to push the visit some hours. For your own safety, you should only visit this location during falling tide, and the stones can be extremely slippery, so bring proper footwear and maybe even protective gloves. As with all photos, you as the photographer is responsible for whatever is inside your frame and how you compose your picture. For my style of photography, this was one of the easier places to photograph, and as always, I've moved around a lot to find the optimal angle. Because the clouds move diagonally through my composition, I decided to skip the effect of a long exposure. But it didn't matter, since the lines of rock made all the depth I needed in the picture, and the different cracks in the clouds made a few leading lines anyway. During the summer half of the year, the sun rises behind the rock, which can make for some amazing photos. In addition, this is a location where I'd say it's self-explanatory to bring an ultra-wide angle lens. It has been a childhood dream of mine to visit Stonehenge. Even though it's one of England's most visited tourist attractions outside of London, I've never seen photos from Stonehenge on the social medias. I did have some ideas for what I wanted from this location, but my main objective was to play tourist for a day. Not many years ago, the area around Stonehenge got a makeover. It is now a full-blown tourist attraction, which is for the better. There's a huge car park, and you'll have to buy your tickets beforehand through the website for a certain time of day. But when you're in, you can stay as long as you want. When you registered your ticket, you can either visit the museum or take a shuttle bus to the stones. There's a trail leading you around the stone circle, which you have to follow, and you're not allowed to enter the stones. From a photographer's perspective, this is perfect. You might be limited in your compositions, but you will not have a trillion tourists walking in front of your camera. If you, however, want to photograph Stonehenge from inside the circle or during sunset or sunrise, there are special tours for that too.
It's hard to believe, but I am at Stonehenge. Stonehenge is for me one of the most legendary locations in the entire world. When I was small, I watched this documentary on astronomy, and in one of those episodes, they were talking about historical astronomy, and a lot of that episode was dedicated to Stonehenge. It has been a boyhood dream of mine to visit this place for I don't know how many years, and now I'm finally here.
For the uninitiated, Stonehenge is mostly known to be an old calendar that marks different dates throughout the year, such as midsummer and midwinter. The approximately 4,300 years old stone circle has probably also had many other more or less religious functions throughout history.
In regard to photography, I have spent the past two and a half hours of just walking around the stone circle and trying to find compositions and come up with ideas. It's in the middle of the day, so the sun is high in the sky, which is normally not very optimal for photography or landscape photography. Luckily, there's a lot of clouds today, so I've been able to make a lot of moody shots. On top of that, there's also some really high-hanging clouds, and I got a halo around the sun, which I managed to photograph above the stone circle. So that is really nice. I'm looking very much forward to edit that picture. My original intent was to photograph it without harsh shadows, so it would be easily converted into a night picture. And then I would, of course, combine it with a Milky Way photograph I have taken at another location.
A standard zoom lens should be fine here, unless you want to go to extremities like I do.
It's hard to put into words what this place really means, but if you have any interest in history or astronomy or culture or anything, this is just a must-see location.
I could easily spend way more time in southern England than we did. The land, trees, rocks, and even towns feels older and richer on history and myths than most of what you can find in Denmark. It is easy to see where that special English vibe derives from when you drive through the countryside. Even though there are no very tall mountains in southern England, the countryside is rich on diversity in the forests, the moors, the coasts, which are absolutely beautiful. So thank you so much for watching, and thanks for all those comments and thoughts on the first video. It has by far and large been my most successful video yet, thanks to all you who've seen it. And reading through all the comments with your thoughts on my photos has been very interesting. And on that note, since it was such a popular event, let's just continue it this week. Here are the 6 photos I've showed in the video, and yes, I know that compositing for some people is a highly no-no, so no reason to waste your time on explaining that technique is the reason you don't like it. Take a look at the photos, choose one, analyze it, and explain why you like it. Thomas Eaton was so nice to give me a shout out in his latest video, which is a very enlightening video, so I put it in my educational photography list. And if you haven't seen it, be sure to check that one out. There is a link in the upper corner right now. That shout out of course also resulted in a good amount of traffic, so a very warm welcome to all you new subscribers. If you haven't checked out my intro video, my name is Mads Peter Iversen and I'm a Danish fine art landscape photographer. Over the past year I've put out a video each week from one or several more or less iconic landscape photography locations from Iceland, the Faroe Islands, the US and continental Europe. If you ever seek out new adventures or need some inspiration, those videos might be a good place to start. As always, I'd highly appreciate a like, and I hope you will participate in the little photography analyzing exercise in the comments below. In the next episode, we'll visit the fascinating and epic Snowdonia National Park in Wales. Snowdonia was one of the locations I looked forward to the most, and I wasn't disappointed by what it delivered.